is liable?
Corporation.
The corporate entity itself, right? That means that if a corporation is sued for either a violation of contractual liability or for the corporate negligence, and corporate negligence is essentially the acts of the employees that are negligent, you know, that the corporation is responsible for. Any assets of the corporation, if the corporation doesn't, is not sitting on enough cash or doesn't have enough insurance to cover those liabilities, either those contractual liabilities or again liabilities for negligence, corporate assets can be used to have to satisfy that judgment, i.e. whatever the corporation owns. Equipment, real estate, inventory, whatever it is, could potentially be seized to have to pay off that judgment. Of course, this is assuming that the corporation does not have sufficient insurance. Hopefully they do, in which case insurance might cover all or part of it, but if they don't, the corporate assets become at risk. Make sense? Okay, and we'll talk a good deal more about that when we get into torts, but this kind of sets that, you see how closely tied the torts lecture is going to be to corporations and partnerships, and you'll see that again on the final, but okay. Like I said, as a general rule, owners, officers, and directors are not personally liable. There is an exception, however, and that is if what we refer to the corporate veil is pierced. That means that, so the concept of piercing the corporate veil means that shareholders might not have that protection if the corporate veil is pierced and might indeed be personally liable. When is that corporate veil potentially pierced? In Florida, in only rare circumstances. And that is if the corporation was established with intent to defraud or with criminal intent.
Has that ever happened?
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Is there an example that we might know?
Yeah, I mean, she could think of a good example.
Enron?
I'm sorry?
Enron, that was different.
Well, yeah, see, that is a distinction, because simply because a corporation engages in fraud, employees engage in criminal activity, that is not enough to pierce the corporate veil. What it has to be is if the corporation was formed with intent to engage in criminal activity, or with a business model essentially in place with intent to, that was designed with intent to defraud. Now you're going to make me go home and try to find some good.
So I'm just curious to see what that might be.
I have a question.
Hopefully I never did business with anyone.
Yeah, yeah.
You're probably going to think I'm crazy. But Breaking Bad. Like, the guy is
dealing
crack, and he buys this, what is it, a car wash or something? And he's using it literally to launder his money.
That I've actually used that example. It's funny that you said
is
Breaking
that
Bad.
What you're
but yes, that's an example.
Okay.
You're using a company to money launder.
Or like the mom.
Right.
That kind of thing too, like, yeah.
A drug operation.
Or a restaurant or
yes.
something.
Yeah, that would be an example of intent to defraud. It appears like a valid car washing business, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't know enough about the show to...
My understanding was, yeah, basically he was charging, people were paying a smaller amount for the car wash, but everything financially was a higher amount so that he could funnel the money.
If it was formed with intent to defraud the IRS like that, which is what it sounds like, that's intent, you know, that is intent to defraud, and thus he could indeed be personally liable. Because, you know, why do you give personal liability protection to somebody who's intentionally engaging in criminal activity? You know, you don't give them that protection. So yeah, that's a hypothetical, but sounds valid enough to me, example, right? Other states. Now, Florida's strict, okay? Because you've got to have that intent to defraud or criminal intent. Other states, however, and I say this to you in case, you know, you might not live the rest of your lives in Florida, that other states do have situations where a corporation or a shareholders of a corporation can be personally liable. The veil will be pierced if there is commingling of personal and corporate assets.
Mm-hmm.
And that can happen real easily, especially in a family-owned business. Okay, like you think about a traditional small family-owned business. How easy would it be, you know, if you're not real strict about making sure that there's a separate corporate account and personal account, if you have vehicles that are owned that are used for both personal and corporate purposes. In a small business, it's not difficult to imagine how easily that could happen. In other states, courts will indeed pierce the corporate veil if there is inappropriate commingling of personal and corporate assets. Florida, though, as a general rule, does not. So, I always maintain, regardless of what the Florida court's position is on it, you should always be very careful to not commingle personal and business assets for a variety of tax reasons and, you know, other potential liability reasons, but just understand that other states are are a little more likely to pierce. Does that all make sense? Any questions about that?
That pertain, like, so I work for a company, and the owner came in one time. I refused to do it, but he asked me to write company checks,
mm-hmm.
to pay, like, his babysitter for his kids, his car payment, like, it was like 10 checks.
Mm-hmm.
Even though Florida doesn't really do that, would that be considered commingling? Because you're using company assets being cash,
mm-hmm.
to pay personal debts, basically.
I would say so. In Florida, it wouldn't be enough to necessarily pierce the corporate veil. But if
and
you were in a state other than Florida that did deem commingling a basis to pierce the veil, I would say that it would be. Yeah, I'd say that it certainly could be. Okay, any other questions about that? All right. Shareholders can indeed be officers or directors or both. If you think about it, again, kind of your small family-owned business, four shares, A and B, each own two and two. A and B could very easily, you know, they are shareholders, they own the whole entity. They could also be officers and directors of the corporation. They're the ones responsible for running it, and they're the ones responsible for managing it. Okay, so don't think that there's this really strict delineation between officers and directors and shareholders. There are, when you get into, you know, massive corporations, right? You know, it's not a requirement. Okay. We talked about fiduciary duties in the context of partnerships. Those same fiduciary duties exist in corporations. Officers and directors owe a fiduciary duty to shareholders, because they are the owners, to run the corporation in such a way that it makes it profitable. So the corporation is making money. Again, engaging in good faith and fair dealing and sound business practices, best practices, things like that. They have a responsibility to act with due diligence. They have that responsibility to act with a duty of loyalty. All of those duties that we talked about are duties that officers and directors owe to the shareholders. Again, that doesn't mean that there's a responsibility to always be profitable. But, like I said, very much a subject of shareholder litigation, because shareholders want to see a profitable corporation. That's why they own shares in a corporation the vast majority of the time. You often hear the concept of due diligence. I use the term due diligence when we're talking about corporate valuation, determining what the value of a corporation would be in a privately held context, assessing assets and liabilities to determine share price. You can also see the concept of due diligence in mergers and acquisitions. That means if a corporation is going to buy another corporation, a merger, an acquisition, that responsibility of due diligence exists to thoroughly investigate all of those financials before going through with the purchase, and not take any action which adversely affect the shareholders' rights. Shareholders can have, there's many different forms of ownership of shares and different rights that come with owning shares depending upon how a share is classified. Sometimes when you buy a share in a corporation, like if you just went onto your Ameritrade account, depending on Some shares that you purchase simply give you the financial piece. They are non-voting shares, which means, you know, you own, you've got that fractional ownership, you own that percentage of the corporation, but you don't have the ability to vote on corporate decision-making practices. Sometimes you'll buy shares that do have voting rights, and you do have the ability, often by proxy, to send in a vote on a particular issue. Okay, depends upon how the share is classified, whether it's voting or non-voting. There's also classes of shares, A shares, B shares, preferred shares, things like that. You know, that can go into these various different aspects of voting rights and voting power. And we'll talk about that more when we get into S shares in a second. But just understand that, you know, shares can come with different benefits, so to speak. A corporation has constitutional rights just like an individual does. A corporation has a right of free speech. So I just want you to understand that those constitutional rights that are given to individuals are essentially given to corporations as well. Corporations can be incorporated anywhere and do business in Florida so long as they have received from the Florida State, Department of Financial Services, permission to do business in Florida. Basically, they have to register with the state of Florida and seek permission to do business in Florida. It is not at all uncommon for businesses doing business in Florida to be incorporated elsewhere. One of the states is one of the most popular states in the country to incorporate in is Delaware. It's where I went to law school. Always been interested in corporate business forms, and so for somebody who wanted to go into corporate law like I did, Delaware was a really, you know, kind of a natural choice because such a focus on corporate law there. Why is Delaware so incredibly popular for corporations? They have a tax structure that exists that's very, very favorable to corporations, and they have a court of chancery there that has a very, very well-versed judiciary in corporate shareholder litigation. So, there's a lot of expertise in that state as it relates to shareholder derivative litigation, which is very favorable to corporations. So just because a business is doing business in Florida does not mean that they are a Florida corporation. They very well could be incorporated in somebody else, but they do have to receive that permission to do business here. Okay, some disadvantages of the corporation. We talked about all these different advantages. One of the main disadvantages is in the taxation of a corporation. And that is because of the fact that a corporate entity is taxed. Corporate taxation is such that there is double taxation. So what that means is that Corporation ABC will be taxed at the corporate rate. Under President Trump's new tax plan, this is now 21%. Okay, it used to be 35, but it's now 21%. That means that the corporation will have to pay 21% in taxes to the federal government. Then, the amount that each shareholder will be taxed at their own individual rate on their proceeds that they are personally responsible for under their personal tax returns. So there's two layers of taxation here. The corporation is taxed at the existing corporate tax rate, now 21%, and then the individual shareholders will also be taxed on whatever their proceeds are based upon their own personal taxation rate. One way or the other, you can see that this is a less favorable tax structure than a partnership, or for that matter, an LLC. Because this doesn't exist in those other forms. That double layer of taxation. Okay? Any questions about that? Please don't ask me a whole lot of tax questions. But I promise I won't test you on a whole lot of tax questions, other than for you to be sure that you understand the concept of double taxation versus pass-through taxation. I mean, how's it legal?
Okay, so if the company earns a dollar, So the company pays 21 cents out of that dollar.
Yes.
In taxes.
Right.
And you receive
79 cents.
Sure.
Because you're a sole shareholder.
So that's
right.
Your income.
So now you pay 28% tax on that 79 cents.
Yes.
So
exactly
now
right.
The company, that dollar that the company earned has been taxed a total of 49%.
Yes.
How is that legal? You're double taxing the same money.
Choose a different business form.
Okay.
It's like the dividends. The dividends
really?
Are given back to the shareholders, right? So it's like you're earned and you get income then.
There's
like
a there's a multitude of different reasons why. Obviously, the example that I gave was simple, that you gave was simple.
Right.
There's a multitude of different reasons as it relates to dividends and share classes and things like that, where corporations can quite frankly come out ahead in this structure. I made it sound doom and gloom and bad because I'm just keeping it, you know.
I just always
really pretty
that.
High level.
Like I knew that happened.
Sure, and it does. And this is the base. This is the structure. This is what it is. But yeah, clearly the more favorable situation from a tax standpoint in our basic examples is to do an LLC or.
So for small businesses, you're more likely to come out ahead in an LLP or an LLC than you are in a corporation.
Depending upon how their shares, and then we can really get into corporate tax, which could be complicated. But for our purposes, yes.
Okay.
Yes. Yes.
You never mentioned, but you started to say that there's C corporations and S corporations.
Yes. That was next on my list.
Oh, okay.
Yes. S corporations. Okay. That covers C corporations. S corporations essentially stands for small corporations. Okay. A small corporation that is classified as an S corporation, guess what? Doesn't deal with this problem. An S corporation has the benefit of pass-through taxation, not the double taxation. If you want to be a small business and you want to organize as a corporation, being an S corporation instead of a C corporation gets rid of this pesky little taxation problem. Okay? The owners are simply taxed at their individual rate. You don't have the entity taxed itself. A disadvantage of an S corporation is that you can't have multiple classes of shares. You know how I talked about how there's, you could have preferred shares or non-preferred, class A, class B. You can't do that with an S corporation. So you can't get into those more complex layers of share classes in a S corporation. But what you can have, though, is voting versus non-voting shares in an S corporation. That is why, just in my opinion, my experience, S corporations are really, really good for family businesses. And sadly to say, especially good if there is a like a divorce or a dissolution of marriage or a generational transfer of the business. Because what can happen in that scenario is that the S corporation can be structured into voting and non-voting shares. So for example, if you have a ex-husband, you and your husband own a business, and your ex-husband wants the financial benefit of the corporation going forward, but you're coming to an agreement that you don't want your ex-spouse to have decision-making control in the management of the business, could be structured so that he would have a non-voting shares, which would basically allow him the benefit without the involvement, basically. Same kind of thing in generational transfers. Sometimes, you know, a family wants to pass on a business to their three kids. You might have one kid who's entitled to 33% of the business but wants nothing to do with running of the business because they either don't want him involved in the running of the business or, you know, a kid doesn't want to be involved. It can be structured with non-voting shares so that that goal is met. So it can be favorable for family businesses in many respects. Make sense? All good with that? All right. I am going to go late. I apologize. I will take no offense if anybody leaves, but I just want to make sure. I'm more concerned with covering this well than I am than racing out of here by 8:30. So,